Welcome to Programming with Professor Califf. Today I'd like to talk about how we create objects in Java and how we call their methods. The first thing we need to have in order to create an object is a class that defines what the object will look like. We'll eventually learn to write our own classes, but for right now we'll use classes that already exist. For this video, I'm going to use a very simplified savings account class, which I've provided to you. If you've not yet downloaded the savingsaccount.java file, I encourage you to pause the video and download it to your computer so that you can follow along. We also need to know what the class offers, what methods it has, and what information we can or should provide when we make objects of this class. There are a few different ways we can get this information. One way would be to look at the code for the class, but that includes a lot of details that we don't really care about in order to use objects of the class. One of the reasons we like the concept of classes and objects is that it keeps us from having to worry about all the details in the class once it's written. So that won't be our approach for now. Another way we can look at a class is to look at the UML class diagram for the class. This gives us a nice overview of the class in a standard format. Here's the class diagram for the savings account class. It shows us the data the objects contain, though that's not a major concern for us in using the class. However, it also shows us what methods the class provides. In this particular case, we have three constructors, which is how we're actually going to create the savings account class. One that doesn't take any information, one that takes a start balance, and one that takes a start balance and also specifies the interest rate on the account. We also have four different what we call methods that are just standard methods. One is getBalance that will return the balance to us, so that's how we're going to find out what the balance in the account is right now. One takes an amount to deposit and adds it to the balance. One withdraws money from the account. And one handles end of month processing for the account. Now the class diagram is a useful tool, but it doesn't actually provide any explanations. Therefore, we often look at what we call API documentation for the class. Java provides a standard format for such documentation and a standard way to generate it, which is called JavaDoc. Here's the JavaDoc for the savings account class. And you can see this is just an HTML document that I'm pulling up in Chrome. Let's go to the top of it. We can see the name of the class, and then we see summary information, which gives us some of the information from the class diagram. So this is very similar, except that we have some descriptions as well as the actual information about calling the class and what the code looks like. In addition to the summary information that matches what's in the class diagram, we do also have details. So if I click on one of these, I will go to a detail. Now there's not a lot of information in some of them, but some of them we can see that they have descriptions for these things in the parentheses, and that can be very useful to us. We also see that for the one getBalance, it has a description for what gets returned, the balance in the account. Fairly clear that that's what getBalance would return, but we're going to know that there are cases where we have more complex classes where these explanations can become very important. Now that we know how to see what options we have in using the class, let's actually look at how we use it. So I'm going to start by opening Eclipse. Let's start by making a new project, so a new Java project, and we'll create a, let's call this object practice, and as usual, I'm going to skip the module info Java file. Let's open up the object practice, and before I actually create my class to practice making objects, I need to actually have access to the savings account class. So how we're going to do that is we're going to import the savings account class into our project. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to right click on the source file. I'm going to go down to import and choose that. Now you may find that you're not at this stage. If it looks like this, just open up general and then pick file system. So that's going to allow me to import a file from the file system. The next thing will take me to a place where I can browse. So browse, I'm going to go to my D drive at the top level. Now this is very important to understand. I cannot see any of the files here. This is only showing me folders. What I'm doing is picking a folder. The reason it works this way is that it's very frequent that we want to import a bunch of files from the same place. And so what it does is it picks a folder and then we choose the files to import from that folder. So my folder is just going to be the top of my D drive because that's where I have the file. Find whatever folder you put the savingsaccount.java file in. Select that, and then we'll see all of the files that happen to be in that folder and click to check savingsaccount.java. Then we can finish. And if we open source and default package, we'll see that savingsaccount.java is there. So now I also want to create the class that I'm going to use to play with some of these objects. So let's go ahead and do new class as we usually do. I'm going to go ahead and call this class also object practice. I'm going to go ahead and click that I do want main and finish that. So now that we're in object practice, we can start to create objects. So to create an object, we are setting up a variable. So the first thing we need for any variable is a declaration. And the type for an object will be the class that the object belongs to. So in this case, that's going to be savings account. And I'm going to call this account one, abbreviated, because it doesn't really have any important things. Now at this point, I've declared my variable. But just like with a primitive variable, I haven't put a value in it yet. So I can't use it yet. It would be uninitialized if I tried to use it. So I do need to give it a value. The way I give an object variable a value is to use the keyword new. So anytime I make a new object in Java, I'm always going to say the object is new. And then I need to call what's called a constructor, which tells Java what class I'm using and what information, if any, I want to provide as I create the object. So in this case, I'm making a savings account object, and I'm going to start by using what we call the default constructor. It's called default because it gets all default values. We didn't provide any special values for this object. So that will create the savings account object. Now we want to do things with it. So the first thing I want to do is just find out what is the balance in the account. So let me remind you. So we have a get balance method here for savings account. So that has a double that it returns that's supposed to be the balance in the account. So we're going to go use that. So I'm going to make a double and I'm going to call that account balance and make that be account balance dot account one dot get balance. And now I'm going to print that since I want to know what it is. And so we'll print with a label. Always want to use a label. And we'll make that account balance. So let's see what happens. Turns out the default balance for a savings account is 0. And this is not terribly surprising to me, because if we don't know what the balance should be, probably ought to start out at 0. So let's try looking at another one. Now, as we do a lot of these, we would need a lot of variables here. So I'm going to show you a trick that I don't have to actually put the value into a variable and then use the variable in the print line. I can actually do account1.getBalance right here in the print. It will get that value and then print it out. So let's prove that real quickly, comment that out and run. And we see the exact same thing happens. And this will be useful to us because I want to look at more than one account. So let's make another savings account. This one will be account 2. And I'm going to use a different constructor here. So remember, the constructor is what we call this special method that we call when we're creating one. So let's and take a look at our other constructor options. So I have another one that allows me to specify the balance in the account. So I'm going to use that. And say, I want to start with $500. And then I'm going to go ahead and print that balance out. If I can successfully copy and paste. And we'll make that account 2 and this account 2 and run that. And we can see here that account 1's balance is 0, but account 2's balance is 500. And we have one other option here where we can actually specify the interest rate as well as the balance. So I'm going to set up an interest rate of 2%, which is 0.02. We almost never deal with percentages as whole numbers here. Instead, we're dealing with them as the whatever divided by 100 that they really are, because we need to do calculations. And let's go ahead and print that balance out as well. So now, as we've been looking at what's in here, I've actually already shown you how to call methods, because we called this getBalance method. The way calling methods works is we're going to have the name of the object, so the variable that refers to the object, and then a dot, and then the name of the method. And then sometimes we need to provide some additional information. So if we come back here, look at our other methods, things like withdraw or deposit, we'll see that in the parentheses, they specify something. And this is something we call a parameter. You'll also hear the term argument used when we're talking about actually providing information to the method. This tells us how much to withdraw. So it basically ends up working like a variable in the method, saying, okay, here's how much we actually want to do the withdrawal for. So let's go see what this withdraw method looks like. Now here, I'm not returning anything, so I'm just calling the method. It's like a statement, like the print line is actually a method call. So account one dot, and I wanted to do a withdrawal. Now you'll notice something very nice about Eclipse and other development environments you might use will also have this capability in many cases, where it's going ahead and telling you, okay, here's a method that this class has that might be the one you're trying to type. And at this point, if I hit return, it will actually fill all this in for me. And then it says, well, you need an amount to withdraw. I'm going to just withdraw $10. And I'm going to call this with each of my variables. And then I'm going to print out the result. So when I run this, I see the original balances, and then I'll notice the withdrawal here doesn't let me withdraw the money if I don't have the money. So the account one balance is still zero, but I did withdraw the money from account two and account three. Now, this is a very simplified version. The money just sort of disappeared. This is just recording what happened in essence. And the same kind of thing can be done with other things, with other methods. So the deposit method, you may have noticed, also had a parameter of amount to deposit. See what happens if I deposit in account two. I'm going to deposit 500. So at that point, it should have the same amount of money as account three. So I'm going to go ahead and print just two and three and see what happens. And we'll see that they're both 990. Now, another thing I want you to be aware of is that these are all operating on the information in them. So an example of that would be what happens with monthly processing. So at this point, both account two and account three are 990. But account two uses the default interest rate, which happens to be 1.25%. And account three uses the interest rate we provided, which was 2%. So they should have different results. Now notice it's not going to be 2% increase because this is monthly processing and the interest rate, as usual, is an annual rate. So it's actually going to be 1.25 divided by 12 or 2% divided by 12 that we're applying to the account. But let's go ahead and do this and see what this looks like. So account two dot process end of month and account three dot process end of month. Now in this case, we didn't have any parameters because there wasn't any information from outside the object that's needed. This is just an update, a change that's being done within the class, within the object, no reference to any other information. So let's go ahead and print both of those out. So this is going to compute the interest and add it to the balance. And we'll see that we added different amounts to the two balances because they had different interest rates. Thanks for watching. In the next video, we'll take a look at object variables and some of the things we need to be aware of about Java object variables. And then we're going to start looking at some different classes that Java provides for us that we can use by creating objects and calling their methods.